Requiem for a Gypsy, a Commander Jana Matinova investigation, by Michael Genelin, narrated by Suzanne Toren. Chapter 1. The old man in the Dodger's cap walked down one of the center aisles of the Saturday outdoor market on Boulevard Richard Lenoir. It was early enough in the morning to avoid the crowd that would be there in the next hour. As always when in Paris, he visited the huge market to re-experience the sights, sounds, and smells of the city he'd first enjoyed so many years ago. It took him, for the moments he was there, out of the modern Paris that was losing so much of its character. Too much clogging motor traffic, too many fast food chains, supermarkets, and girls in gym shoes and baggy stained khakis. And, of course, there was the array of beggars. Outside the market, he saw the very essence of what he thought of as French coming under attack. Here, the old Paris was still present. The merchants in their separate stalls under the canvas, the vegetable stand staffers shouting their specials, the fishmongers extolling fresh cod and bream, the pastry and bread stands wafting their scent over the neighboring rows, competing with the bouquets of the olive stands, which boasted dozens of differently colored, sized, and seasoned olives. These, in turn, complemented and contrasted with the smell of the chickens turning on spits and sausages being stewed, fried, or roasted in the stands farther down the aisle. The booths went on for blocks, and Pascal, as he was known in Paris, made sure to traverse the whole market, picking up tidbits from here and there to keep him in edibles for the next several days. The scene was like an old movie that had been colorized, so vividly chromatic that it made him feel as if he were inhabiting a rainbow dream made of food. When the main body of the Saturday shoppers arrived to crowd the aisles, Pascal sighed, disappointed that his comfort time was over, but ready to leave, his purchases stored in the two-wheeled shopping cart he'd bought a few days earlier. Once you get on in years, the prospect of carrying bundles in your arms, even just for the few blocks he had to walk to his apartment, becomes onerous. So he'd brought the cart, even though it was not regarded as the masculine thing to do. Pascal crossed over to the other side of the boulevard, glancing up at the golden-winged figure at the top of the monument on the former site of the Bastille, then walked the short distance around the traffic circle to Saint-Antoine, making his way from the monument toward the tourist-friendly Saint-Paul area where he had his apartment. He walked a few blocks, and then, like so many Parisians do, perceiving that it was safe to ignore the traffic light, he cut across Saint-Antoine. The old man never saw the truck that hit him. Almost the exact center of the front bumper struck Pascal, the blow scattering his cart and groceries and sending Pascal himself flying through the air, slamming through the plate glass of a bus stop, its shards raining all over the street. Pascal was killed on impact, so many of his bones broken that he looked like a jelly-filled scarecrow when he was put into a body bag and lifted onto the coroner's gurney. The truck driver had driven on as if he hadn't just killed a pedestrian, abandoning the truck several blocks from the collision. The truck proved to be stolen, so the police could not find anyone to hold responsible, which always angers police officers. And Pascal had three separate sets of ID on his person, which made things even more troubling for them. After all, how can you notify the decedent's next of kin, or even inform his landlord, if you don't know who he was or where he lived? The problem was passed on to the detective bureau. The detective assigned to the case sent queries out to both Europol and Interpol, transmitting photographs of the dead man, shots of several tattoos found on his body, prints taken from him in the morgue, and all the names on his IDs. Let them do their job for a change, the detective reasoned. While he waited for identification on the victim, he moved forward to his next pending case. They were all piling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.